possible. Okay? Depend on your application. And the element is some form of good behavior. I'll be more specific, of course. Now, the reason that I'm not specific about all of these models is that there are so many different things that will influence what the algorithm, the model, and so forth. They all depend on how complex your model is and your system is. There's lots of uncertainty that you want to capture. Actions, maybe even deterministic or stochastic, that is have probabilistic effects. We have often a case where we cannot observe the state of the system perfectly. We can only observe part of it. I only know what's happening here in this room. I have no idea what's going on over there. If I want to get coffee, I don't know if the coffee counter is closed or not. Okay? So this is partial observability, and in order to remove, to make more observation, I have to sense. I have to maybe walk over there and look at things. As in the example of that problem, in order to figure out if the path to the dog, to the blue thing was clear, it had to observe. It had to look at the object and figure out if the area is clear. And temporal actions, you know, our actions can take time, and while they take time, they change things gradually, or they may be instantaneous and change, you know, your computer system, when you write a command, it's like this. But when a robot tries to execute a complex command, it takes time, and things happen while it's doing it. You may have concurrency, and especially in the multi-agent case, interaction with other agents. And of course, multi-agent case, which we'll talk about after the break. And so there really are a lot of things to do. And of course, in this very short tutorial, I cannot describe all the details.
So a model describes the relevant aspects of the world.
The language of the interpretation will cease soon, and the query is to find a language in the sequence of actions that takes us from the initial state to a goal state. And the algorithm, well, it's natural for you because you've studied computer science, you can think of an automaton as a big graph. We have a certain state here, we have a state in 1 degree here. What do? You can find a path very easy, the Dijkstra, right? Dijkstra algorithm and solve the problem. And I'm pretty much into this here because you know what Dijkstra is, you can use it, then I can go home. Well, that's it. Here's a simple transition system. This is the classical box world. It's a very simple and nice thought example to illustrate the ideas, even though, of course, it's not what we want to do with planning. So we have here three blocks. They can be in various configurations on the table. They can either be one on top of the other, or they can be on the table. And you can see here there are about 13 possible states of the world. And although there is no label on the action, the entire arrows basically represent actions. So the actions are to pick a block from one location and put it on another location. Another location could be another block, or it could be the table. So the state of the world is basically the automaton. The actions are basically the letter or the edges in a condition system. The initial state is now here, for instance, S1 is the initial state. The goal state is what are known as the absorbing states often in the automaton theory. So let's say S9 is a cube. A goal state and plan is a word, basically a sequence of letters that will transition you Now, the action has the form moves x from y to z. By the way, you know, are you happier with no air conditioning during me or with more air conditioning
during me? Want to try and open the windows?
Oh, that's a good idea. Okay. Okay, now this is an action of moving one object from another object to a third object. Okay? So in order to move x from y to z, x has to be on y. X has to be clear, we cannot move a block into another block on top, okay? And z, well, is hidden there, z is either not, if z is not the table, then z also has to be clear. So the table always has space to put a block on it, but another block might have to put this block on this block, it has to be clear. The effect is that you see the small line is there and for not. X is no longer on y. X is on z. Z is no longer clear, and y is clear. So this is a description of how, using this very simple notation, I describe to you the effect of the action. Here's another action, and this is for moving x from on top of y to the table. It's a little simpler because the table is always here, so you just have to make sure that x is clear and x is on y. And after you move the x from y, then x is no longer on y, x is on z, and y is clear. Here's another example. This is the logistic domain that I mentioned. So every state of the one described the location of packages in the partition airplane. Initial state, we have package P1 in the post office in Tanya, P2 in Hotel Alepa, and P3 in Beersheba, and the truck in the Heraklion Airport and the truck in Beersheba. Okay, there is also an airplane in the Heraklion Airport. And the goal is to basically switch the package. You want P1 and P2 to be in Beersheba, and P3 to be in Hotel Alepa. The actions that we have is load, unload packages into or from a truck. And we can move the truck from one place to another, and we can move and we can fly a plane between airports. Okay, we can move trucks between one place to another in the same country, and of course we can fly a plane between the airports. So here are the propositions. So we have, for instance, at P1 Tanya Post Office, at P1 Alepa, at P1, but these are different propositions now, describing any possible situation, location of package P1. And similarly, you have the same for P2 and for P3. Then you have the location of the, you have propositions describing possible location of the trucks and the planes. So it's a long history proposition. And you can understand, I mean, this is only, this is a very simple example, three packages, two trucks, one airplane. And this is only the proposition describing the location of one package. Add all the other propositions, you have, something like 1, 2, 3, 4. Let's say around 30 propositions. How many possible assignments is it? 2 to the 30? You get something bigger. This is for three packages. So imagine you want to model a realistic example, you have a huge set of propositions. That's fine, you have a few hundreds of them or a few thousands of them. And if you wanted to model the graph that is describing how you move between any possible state of the world, that would be, you know, 2 to the 300, 2 to the 400, or 2 to 1,000, you would not be able to represent this. So in the initial stage, I'm just listing here the propositions that are assigned through. So the package 1 is in Tanya, package 2 in Alepa, package 3 in Beersheba, quick package in Heraklion Airport, the Israeli package in Beersheba, and the plane is in Heraklion. And the goal, this is the goal, we want to make sure that these propositions are true. Okay, the action. The action to load the package into a vehicle in a certain location. So the precondition is that the package is in the location and the vehicle is in the location. And the effect is that the package is no longer in the location, but rather the package is in the vehicle. Similarly, for unload, I did is what works the best. And the key here is via a heuristic forward search. It means that we need to get very good heuristic functions for the search. And this is what I did the major development in the last, let's say, 10 years of planning. Automated generation of very powerful heuristics that guide the search efficiently. So although the space that we want to search is huge, it's exponential in the number of variables, we are able to then see how you compute heuristic values using these two techniques. The first is very simple, I think it's called combining all the states to make the package.